be talking about cannabis, its formulation and physiology. My objectives will be to talk about the formulation, both natural and synthetic, and talk about the physiology of cannabinoid system, starting from THC and CBD. Then I will talk about endocannabinoids, which is anandamide and 2-AG. And I will also talk about cannabinoid receptors, CB1 and CB2, and their function. And I will end with summary. So no talk about cannabis is complete without talking about a little about history of cannabis. So let's talk a little about the history of cannabis. So people dates it back to 12,000 years ago, the origin of cannabis in Central Asia, especially in the Himalayan foothills. Later in the writings of China, around 2700 BC, and in India in around 2000 BC, it has been used for both as medicinal purpose, recreational purpose, and also it has been found, the major thing is hemp fiber. Around 1600 AD, it has been documented that it has actually grown in Western countries also through because of migration. And during the period of Mughals, it has been found to be the writings about bhang has been noted, and this is the one of the first documentation in medical history, that around 1843 an Indian doctor, a British Indian doctor by name William O. Shaughnessy, and he has written the medical uses of tincture of cannabis. And predominantly, this has been used for rheumatism and also for infantile convulsions. Around 1893, the Indian Hemp Commission report, which is one of the major milestones, where it is a 3,000 pages document. The gist of this document is that in moderate consumption, it has not been found to be harmful. And so this was one of the important things. So another important milestone in the history of cannabis is 1961 United Nations Convention on Narcotic Drugs, which has actually scheduled cannabis in Schedule 1 and Schedule 4. Schedule 4 being the highest level of danger. And in India, it has come into legal constraints after NDPS in 1985. In early part of 21st century, we have been seeing a lot of countries going for decriminalization. Some countries went into legalization of medical cannabis use. Some countries also legalized recreational cannabis use also. One of the important things that we need to know is that in 2020, the CND, a branch of a wing of United Nations, has removed cannabis from Schedule 4 of 1961 Convention, which means that it has removed it from the most harmful substances, but still it is retained in Schedule 1, which is again one of the next to Schedule 4, which is next harmful. So coming to the formulation, there are both natural formulations and synthetic formulation. Coming to natural formulations, the first thing that you need to know is differences between male and female plant. So it is researched that male plant has lesser amount of THC content compared to female plant. However, female plant, if it gets pollinated, the content of THC comes down. So there is a method called as Cincimella method, where they prevent pollination of the female plant. And again, based on species, people have classified as cannabis sativa, indica, ruderalis, and afghanica. Most people believe that there is a difference between each species. However, studies were not able to find so the difference. The difference is predominantly based on the genetic strain and age of the plant, sex of the plant, environment in which it grows. The most commonly observed differences between these species is because of the differences in terpenes rather than THC and CBD. The next comes the classification based on the chemical composition, based on chemotype, that is THC and CBD contents, CBD content. There are three different varieties. One is CBD dominant, THC dominant. The third variety is hybrid. Both are at higher concentration. Also, it contains different other chemicals like THCA, THCV, etc. Finally, based on preparations, as you all know, there is bhang, which is made out of leaves, and marijuana or ganja, which is made out of flowers, and charas or hashish, which is again a resin prepared by rubbing of these flowers for a continuous period of time, and hash oil, which is much more potent or concentrated form. It's an oil-based preparation, which is again prepared from hashish. Based on the route of intake, there are different routes in which people take this natural cannabis. One is through smoking, predominantly through joints. What people do is they take the marijuana, they roll in a cigarette paper along with cigarette, or they roll it only cannabis. The second way is through water pipe, which is also called as bong, which actually the combusted cannabis passes through the water before it is inhaled. The third variety is vaporizers, which is again heat no burn devices, which means that it heats the cannabis, but it doesn't burn, and so it doesn't go to the level of temperature where it burns. So there is less carbon monoxide which is released. Then the important thing, the recent form of cannabis intake is dabbing, which is again further more concentrated, and it has been mixed into butane. It contains high potency, and there are also impurities which can lead to other harms. There are also edibles like hash brownies, drinks, cannabis oil, and tincture, which is available for intake. And there are also topical preparations like lotions, balms, creams, which are used for local application. Other varieties like sprays, lozenges, inhalers, rectal and vaginal suppositories are also available. So this is the left side one is how the bong looks like, and the right side one is the vaporizer or the dabbing instrument. So coming to the constituents of cannabis plant, cannabis has more than 500 constituents identified till date, in which around 120 are cannabinoid related compounds, and others are non-cannabinoid constituents. In these, the interested constituents are 9-delta tetrahydrocannabinol and CBD, which is cannabidiol. There is recent surge in interest towards the other compounds also. For example, terpenes, which are predominantly used, which are predominantly aromatic, which gives the flavor. THCV, cannabivarin, which is again 1/4 as potent as THC, and 8-THC is also less potent compared to THC, but again is one of the compound of interest. So if you see a cannabis plant, the fibrous hemp, that is the stem, contains less than 4%, 0.4%, and upper leaves contains the highest potency, lower leaves next highest, stem and seeds less. So it contains less than 1% of cannabis. Through Sinsimella, the potency is increased up to 7 to 14%, and in marijuana, it is up to 8%. And hashish has content of 2 to 8%. Hash oil can go up to 50%, and dab up to 90%. So this is the overview. Marijuana or hashish, which is commonly consumed, and if you isolate the products, there are non-cannabinoid products, cannabinoid products, and in the cannabinoid products, there are psychoactive products like THC, active but not psychoactive cannabidiol. Other inactive components are also found. In the recent last 20-25 years, there has been significant increase in synthetic cannabis. So this comes with the trade name as spice or K2. When the endocannabinoid related research is happening, there are some compounds that have been synthesized which can actually activate these cannabinoid receptors. But these compounds are also produced by some labs outside the research labs, and these compounds during 2000 to 2010 has been sold on internet. So these compounds are sprayed over the herbs and sold as natural products, and till the time it got identified by the FDA or drug control agencies, it has been sold in the internet. So these are produced on synthetically. And one important thing about these compounds are these acts on CB1 and CB2 receptors with high potency. compared to, if you see, THC is a partial agonist. These are full agonists and they have high potency towards CB1 and CB2 receptors. And these also produce serious side effects like CVS and CNS side effects. In CVS side effects, cardiovascular side effects, tachycardia, arrhythmias have been noted. In CNS side effects, seizures, disorientation, and psychosis are some of the major concerns. One of the important things about these synthetic cannabis is these escape regular urine test. So if you see, one of the first formation is JWH018, named after the scientist who discovered it. And there has been multiple modifications of this product so that it doesn't get detected in the urine test. And a brief note on cannabis based medication, which Dr. Deepthali will be talking to you in coming sessions. So there are CBD-based medication, cannabidiol-based medication. Recently, it has been approved for Dravet and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome, Epidiolex. And it has also been tried for various psychiatric disorders. It has been known that cannabidiol reduces the anxiety. So it has been diagnosed as, it has been used for social anxiety disorder. And it is also having, cannabidiol also has antipsychotic effects. So it has been tried in schizophrenia also. And THC-based medications like dronabinol, nebilone, these are traditionally used for chemotherapy-induced nausea, vomiting, HIV-induced cachexia. And recently, the interest has been found in PTSD, opioid dependence, and cannabis dependence. In PTSD, it has been combined with psychotherapy for further in the research. There are mixed compounds which use cannabidiol and THC, like nebiximol, sativex, which has been approved in European Union for muscle spasms in multiple sclerosis. This has also been tried for ADHD and cannabis dependence syndrome. Finally, I got a doubt whether these are dispensed as medications. The cannabis, the medical cannabis in states which is licensed, I got a doubt whether these are dispensed in as medicines or as pure cannabis. So yes, cannabis plants and extracts are also sold in the market. So different varieties, different strains, different concentrations, and it is extracts like oil, tincture are also sold, and also edibles are also sold in the market as medical cannabis. So coming to the physiology, till now we have discussed about phytocannabinoids, CBD, THC and CBD, and these are exogenous cannabinoids. The endogenous cannabinoids include anandamide, UAG. These act on cannabinoid receptors, predominantly CB1 and CB2, and causes various physiological, biological, and immunological, neurological, and metabolic functions. So I will start with the first thing, that is THC, that is exogenous cannabinoids, what happens when they enter our body, then go on to the next topic, endocannabinoids. So coming to the pharmacokinetics, most people take it through as smoking, and THC is highly lipid soluble and low aqueous solubility. As soon as it enters the lungs, it enters the bloodstream, and 90% goes into the plasma and 10% into RBC. And the peak plasma concentration after smoking reaches between somewhere between 3 to 10 minutes. It also depends upon different factors, the content, smoking pattern, etc. And the bioavailability through smoking is 20 to 30%. If you see the peak plasma concentration through oral route, it takes around 1 hour, and the bioavailability is less than 10%. The rapid absorption happens as soon as it enters the bloodstream. Rapidly it gets absorbed into adipose tissue, again comes back into the blood through redistribution. The concentration starts reducing after 3 to 4 hours after inhalation. And the oral route, lower bioavailability and slow absorption, and also slow degradation too. So this is a metabolism where THC gets hydroxylated. It is very important to know this metabolism, because THC gets hydroxylated to form 11-hydroxy-THC. And this 11-hydroxy-THC undergoes oxidation to form carboxy-THC. And further, it undergoes glucuronidation to and excreted. And 90% of it, 65% goes into the feces, and 20% goes into the urine. The compounds, why the understanding this is very important is that when you wanted to test when you wanted to test a person who is taking cannabis, you need to know about these compounds. For example, when we order for a urine drug testing, the most common substance that we detect in the urine drug testing is carboxy THC, that is THC-COOH. And in feces, we detect 11-hydroxy THC. But generally, in general, 9-THC is reabsorbed, so we don't detect very often. So coming to detection, urine, feces, saliva, blood, hair, and nail are commonly used for detection. Most commonly, urine has been used because it stays in the urine for longer time. It is easy to obtain and also easy to analyze. So we have immunoassays as screening tests and chromatographic techniques like gas chromatography, mass spectroscopy, and high-performance liquid chromatography for quantification of the amount of cannabis. Usually, the cutoff is considered as 50 nanogram per ml. So what is the clinical relevance of understanding the physiology? One of the things is when people take cannabis orally, like bhang, they have delayed effect. Second thing is understanding this metabolism. So if a person takes cannabis, if the person takes one joint of cannabis, so it can be detected in urine up to 2 to 3 days. A person takes on a regular basis, maybe once in a day or once in 2 days, it can be detected around 7 to 10 days. In heavy users who take on a daily basis, morning, afternoon, and evening, so in those kind of patients, in those kind of users, it can be detected up to 1 month. So it is also known that it can be detectable in case of passive smoking, in case exposure is high. Interestingly, there was a study from Pakistan where cows have been feeding on the cannabis plants, and the urine drug testing of these children who fed on these cows came positive. So it can also be transmitted through breast milk. So coming to pharmacodynamics, the CB1 and CB2, THC acts on CB1 and CB2 as partial agonists, and THC acts on CB1 and CB2 as a partial agonist, and CBD acts on GPR55, ENT, TRP, M8. So the primary mechanism of action of CBD is not predominantly through CB1 and CB2. It can also indirectly reduce the activation of CB1. So I have included a table which actually tells you about different actions of cannabinoid compounds on different targets. So maybe if slides are shared, you can go through those. So coming to the receptors, there are CB1 receptors which are predominantly in the brain. Where in the brain? These are predominantly in hippocampus, amygdala, basal ganglion, cerebrum, and cerebellum. And these control cognition, reward, and other behavioral functions. CB2 receptors are predominantly in spleen and peripheral tissues, and these are immunosuppressive functions. So this is a neuronal synapse where CB1 receptor is predominantly found in the presynaptic region, and anandamide 2AG are produced in the postsynaptic region. So the anandamide has low or very low agonistic action at CB1 receptor, whereas 2AG has high efficacy agonist at CB1 and CB2 receptor. So there is something called as entourage effect. Entourage effect is that, for example, if there are two compounds, two endocannabinoids, the effect of one endocannabinoid compound synergistically helps in effect of the other endocannabinoid compound. This is also applied true for exogenous cannabinoids like THC and CBD. Although there is a controversy whether this entourage effect happens or not, because there are animal studies which has shown that entourage effect is not found. However, it is important to know what is this entourage effect. Then coming to this cannabinoid receptor activation follows this retrograde synaptic messenger system, which means that when a receptor gets activated, it activates, it on demand asks anandamide and 2AG to be produced. once anandamide 2-AG gets produced, it travels retrogradely, that is from postsynapse to presynapse, and acts on CB1 receptors and causes further activation. What kind of activation happens? Once a CB1 receptor, which is a G protein coupled receptor, activates potassium channels, closes calcium channels, and also activates other secondary messenger systems, which are involved in different functions. So there are three mechanisms through which the CB1 receptor functions. One is depolarization induced suppression of inhibition. So it can suppress inhibition. It can also suppress excitation, and it can also cause long-term depression, which is long-term inhibition of neurotransmitter release. So there is suppression also, there is excitation also. So what is the net function? The net function is it actually regulates neuronal excitability. So there is other important thing that you may also need to know is degradation of these anandamide and 2-AG. So these are degraded into further amino acids through MAGL, FAAH, and prostamines through COX-2. So one important thing is that inhibitors of these FAAH, MAGL, and COX-2 has been found to be useful to increase the endocannabinoid levels. So which has therapeutic action? These are in pipeline yet to get. For example, FAAH inhibitors has been banned because of certain adverse consequences. So these are in pipeline future medications which are going to come. Coming to the functions of endocannabinoid system. Endocannabinoid system is not only important in fetal brain development, but also in adult synaptic plasticity. It also helps in mood elevation, where through dopamine modulation. It also acts as anxiolytic through its connection to 5-HT receptor, anti-seizures through its connection to through its connection through GABA and glutaminergic. It improves appetite as a part of leptin regulation. It also elevates pain through increasing endogenous opioids. It also reduces nausea through its 5-HT3 receptor modulation. And it also has been found in other reproductive functions, sleep, learning, and memory related functions. So this is a brief mechanism for action, how it helps as an anti-epileptic because of its connections through glutaminergic and GABAergic neurons, inhibition of glutaminergic neurons through CB1 receptor mediated action. Recent interest has been use of implications of endocannabinoid system in schizophrenia. So alterations in endocannabinoid system has been found to the gene genetic alterations in endocannabinoid system has been found to increase the risk of schizophrenia through increase in anandamide and also endocannabinoid further activation of the endocannabinoid system. And it has been observed that these are potential target areas. CBD, which blocks the CB1 receptor, has been found to have antipsychotic effects. And exposure to THC in people who have already had a genetic risk, which is altered endocannabinoid system, further increases the risk. So to summarize, there are multiple formulations of cannabis that are available, and THC is lipophilic. THC is metabolized by liver, eliminated in urine and feces. And endogenous cannabinoids are anandamide and 2-AG. CB1 and CB2 are cannabinoid receptors. So apart from these endogenous cannabinoids like anandamide and 2-AG, there are other things like virodamine, nolandine, etc. Apart from CB1 and CB2 receptor, there are other receptors which are implicated in cannabinoid, which are also thought of cannabinoid receptors like GPR55. And the conduction follows a retrograde transmission, and endocannabinoid system plays an important role in diverse biological functions. So these are some of the references. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.